Coming up next on The Voice of Alabama Politics, Outside Agitators. Also, the V-Team takes a look at the BCA's dumpster fire. And Governor Kay Ivey says she's cleaned up corruption in Montgomery.
Everybody is to leave here immediately. This cafe is closed until further notice. Clear the room at once.
How can you close me up? On what ground?
I'm shocked to find that gambling is going on in here.
You're winning, sir.
Oh, thank you very much. Everybody out at once.
Now, sugar, what's a little public corruption among friends? I mean, it's just politics. All this and much, much more coming up next on The V. Welcome to The Voice of Alabama Politics, where we tackle the tough issues so you have the hard facts. I'm your host, Bill Britt, and as always, I'm joined by the V-Team. Welcome all.
Hey, guys.
Hello.
Hey.
Why's everybody giggling? I don't understand what's going on.
It's Charlie she's jacked up today.
she's a little high.
Yeah. Well,
just a little bit.
Well, nothing that you can't handle.
Right. Right.
So, happy birthday to Susan and
happy birthday
to Josh.
Oh, thank you.
Day apart.
Thank you. That's right. Same age.
Yep, same age.
Is that the terrorist fish pound?
Yeah, it is. Yeah. Or is it terrorist? Yes. Specifically ISIS.
Right?
Yes.
So ISIS terrorist fist pound. I got to tell you, Josh, we're going to have to start with this one. This week, Governor Kay Ivey released perhaps one of the most egregious ads I have seen in politics in the last 5 years. The only other ad I've seen that was more dishonest was when Jay Jones, sheriff of Lee County, said that Mike Hubbard was the most honest man he knows. This week, Kay Ivey came out and said she had cleaned up corruption in Montgomery.
No, nothing. And you know, if you didn't think she could top the monuments ad from a week before, when we looked at it, it was just how. You know, you didn't have to make the claim. You know, she could have just said nothing, and it would have been okay. But to say she's done something, it's absurd. She has done nothing. As with her approach to being governor, is to do nothing and just take credit for everything. But, you know, she has done specifically nothing on corruption. Nothing. Name a bill. Name something that you've done. And the best they had to come out of this was that she fired half of Bentley's cabinet, which I didn't think most of those people were crooks necessarily.
No.
I mean, Art Faulkner and Jim Perdue and those guys, I mean, nobody ever accused them of anything. And then the second thing was an executive order on getting rid of all lobbyists on boards and being appointed to positions in the state, which she just voted for a lobbyist to become a school superintendent. A guy that gave her $2,000.
Threw a pack.
Susan, you know, when I saw that ad and then the accompanying fundraiser, you had to get a box of duct tape.
There wasn't enough duct tape in the state of Alabama for your head, I gotta tell you. And I was right there with you because I sit there and watched her reign over the Senate and never say a word about Mike Hubbard the whole time that on the fifth floor, all of that was going on. Never said a word about Robert Bentley until she took his place. So how did she actually clean that up? She wasn't involved.
Right. I mean, Charlie, I mean, come on. I mean, I don't dislike Governor Kay Ivey, but I mean, you cannot just outright make claims like this and expect us to buy it.
Definitely. And we can't forget, you know, she did just pass HB 317, which literally weakens the ethics laws and opens the door for people to, you know, financially benefit in an unethical manner.
Yes.
But, you know, cleaning up corruption.
Well,
you know, definitely.
She's knocking it out of the park. I mean, but here's the thing that really bothers me is that overall ranking of the state of Alabama, we are 46th. We are four from the bottom in states out of the 50 states. Our health care, Josh, is 46. We're fourth from the bottom in providing health care. Our education, Charlie, we are third from the bottom. Our infant mortality rate is higher than Korea. I mean, how in the world does she stand there and tell us about corruption and mountain oysters when we have problems that are so systemic that only a fool would think that we are going to pander and get these done?
Yeah, I know. You know, you don't have to go and be, you know, a negative about the state, although I'm plenty negative about the state, you know, given where we are, and rightfully so, I think, in a lot of ways. But at the same time, you can't just sit there and say things are better, things are better, things are better, because the unemployment rate is artificially low. I mean, it's not better. It's not better. Their solution for that 46th health care problem that we had there was cutting people out of Medicaid, making them go to work.
Which is where your infant mortality rate is.
Yeah.
I mean, Charlie, half the children in Alabama are born in poverty and have to be born under Medicaid. I mean, this is outrageous. We shouldn't be this way. It should be a better state.
No, it should be a better state. And we certainly should have a governor who, like Josh said, isn't just saying, you know, things are better. You should be actually actively working to make them better.
Now, I got to put a little bit of this on the legislature, too.
Oh,
because
it's
when
not
they're
a long
in
governor.
There,
oh, no, course, no.
When they're in there, they're not talking about these issues. They're talking about deer baiting, monuments, gun laws, gender bathrooms, stuff they know is going to go to the Supreme Court and get kicked back. Yeah.
It's a pandering sort of a thing that they do so often there. And you know, you see the bills that come through there that could help things, that could help, you know, a variety of things. And there's always a problem. There's always, well, we need to get a commission to study this. So we need, you know.
But then they pass Strike 317.
Yeah, they push it through like somebody's life depended on 317.
Yeah, and listen, again, this is systemic. And it's not KIV.
It's
everybody.
Well before KIV.
Yeah, I mean,
well before
is.
This current
but
legislature.
I expected better from her.
They're
I expected
helping.
Her not to pander. And I mean, good Lord, she sent out another fundraiser based on these liberals that are coming down from Washington, D.C. or New York to remove our monuments. Yeah. There is nobody coming to remove the monuments.
No.
They're not coming.
No, they're actually coming to put up a new monument,
you know,
in remembrance of people who were involved in
the only time that our state has gotten better is when these out-of-state liberals showed up to make us do things. I hate to tell you, that's when we've gotten better. And for her not to go to the EJI that's down here.
The Equal Justice Initiative.
With the lynching memorials and things that are going on down here. For her not to show up in her own hometown, knowing the problems that this place has had over the years, not to show up to that is an embarrassment.
Just knowing our history as a city, you know.
Yeah.
I mean, you know, the thing is, Alabama could be great if we had leaders who were willing to take on the tough challenges. Mm-hmm. They do not exist. We haven't had a decent governor since Albert Brewer, and we're not likely to have one in the near future if Kay Ivey and the bunch keep pandering to the lowest common denominator.
Well, guess what, guys? It's an election year. Let's take this election seriously this time.
Yeah. Well, it'd be nice, but you know what? They know something we don't know. But pandering to the base with the monuments, pandering on these issues like this, they are playing to the people who will turn out and vote.
Yeah, listen, this, you know, we can blame the legislature and the governors and people like that, and they certainly deserve some blame. But the people who deserve the most blame are the voters.
That's right.
They get caught up in this nonsense,
exactly.
And they should.
We're going to have to leave it right there. You're watching The V, the voice of Alabama politics. We'll be right back with more news and analysis.
My work and my play take me to all 50 states, but Alabama is still my home. Alabama is where I live, and Alabama is where I vote. I'm Taylor Hicks, and I want you to be a registered voter and to have a qualified government-issued photo ID so you can vote too. Alabama has so much to offer. Let's do all we can to make her the best state she can be.
Autism has touched the lives of so many here in Alabama. It's why State Senator Tom Watley stood up to the special interests and sponsored the bill requiring insurance plans to provide autism therapy to those in need. Because Tom Watley knows this therapy can and does change lives. And Watley was recently recognized by the Autism Society of Alabama for his work helping the autism community. Putting people before politics. Tom Watley.
Welcome back to The V, the voice of Alabama politics. Over the last couple of weeks, we have been reporting on how seven of the most powerful corporate entities in Alabama have gone to the executive board of the Business Council of Alabama and demanded that the CEO, Billy Canary, step aside. Since then, we've reported that the board or the executive committee did agree that he should go. However, Perry Hand, who is the chairman of the board for this term, who also is the chairman of the board of Volcker Inc., a engineering firm out of Mobile, is resisting. The seven biggest corporations are calling for Canary to be gone by June 1. Mr. Hand would like for him to stay around till November. Josh, where's the disconnect?
Well, as somebody once said, all the answers to your question is money. And I think that's where it comes in here. You look at Volcker and what they've been able to accomplish over the years with Billy Canary as in charge of BCA, with Hand in charge of the pack there that's feeding things out from Volcker. You know, that they have really made some money through state contracts. And you know, it's not, you know, you understand it from Volcker's point of view. But at the same time, if you're BCA and you're on that board there and you have the seven largest companies coming to you, the people who foot the bills for all these things saying, hey, this guy's got to go. He's not doing things. And they have legit complaints here. You know, the last couple of sessions have been a disaster for BCA. And you've got a lot of lawmakers around here now who openly dislike Billy Canary and his tactics for doing things. You know, they tie him to my cupboard, rightfully so. And they don't care for the way he's conducted business around the State House over the last few years with kind of a, you know, more of a hammer than a carrot. And so it doesn't make any sense if you're on that BCA board why you're listening to Perry Hand, who has a personal stake in this, and not to these other people who are saying, hey, we're paying the bills, get the guy out of here so we can get some things done.
Well, Susan, one of the things that we did, we were able to look at an email that was written by Mark Crosswhite, the CEO of Alabama Power. It was addressed to the seven companies, and where Perry Hand agreed that there needed to be change at BCA, that Billy Canary had to go. But he keeps holding on to this fall date instead of June. I mean, if Canary hangs on to the fall, why not just keep until the next session? Why not do this, why not do that? But I mean, what choices does Alabama Power, Blue Cross, Blue Shield, Drummond Coal, all these big businesses have if Perry Hand keeps resisting?
If he keeps resisting, and I'm not, I know we all kind of know why they want to hold on to him. They want to hold on to him through the election,
right?
Okay, so that they can place the proper PAC money where they want to put it. But you know, if they don't get some relief here, excuse me, they you know, all of these powerful seven, they can move over to Manufacturing Alabama. They can move on to their new PAC. They can move on, or they can also cut their dues down pretty drastically.
Well, Charlie, I mean, it just seems like that this resistance is futile. But the other thing is, BCA really wants to get this infrastructure gas tax passed, and that's a big part of it. And not everybody's in favor of a gas tax.
No, not everybody's in favor of it. But personally, I think the infrastructure bill, you know, has good qualities to it. But really, most of this Canary stuff, something that really struck me about it is he came out and said that he has made the organization financially sound and stable. So that kind of caught me off guard just a little bit. And I really feel like he knows he's screwed. He's just grasping at straws, trying to save face at this point.
I mean, Josh, that's another one. You're getting ready to lose the seven companies that contribute about $1 million a year. It's splintered into 1,000 pieces. And he's like, oh, but we're stable and found.
Yeah, well, you are with those seven. Yeah. You're doing okay if you've got those seven people there. And, you know, look, he at one point, Billy Canary obviously served their interest pretty well.
Yeah,
you know, and he did. You know, he had connections, he had access, and that's what you're essentially buying here. Is when you're in that position, when you have that amount of money, you're buying, you know, access to people that make the laws, that, you know, control the regulations that affect your businesses. And so that's what they're influencing. That's all, I mean, don't be shy about the whole thing. That's what they're after here. And if he's no longer doing that, he's got no use to them.
Well, let's get to the bottom of one very important lawmaker, as you might say, the one that kind of sits in D.C. and is head of the appropriations
committee. The guy who kind of got the ball rolling.
Yeah, the kind of got, you know, Richard Shelby, he said months ago, he's got to go. And he's told BCA, he told Billy Canary, as long as Billy Canary is there, you're not welcome up here. I will not listen to what you have to do. So what are they gaining by holding on to Billy Canary?
Well, and I think, you know, one of the things that we saw is that Senator Shelby, after he saw, Canary's connections to Hubbard and Riley and all that was exposed during the Hubbard criminal trial, he came out and said, it's time for Canary to go. We need honest business individuals in there running the show and not these shady dudes. Mm-hmm. And so what happened is, as you well know, Josh, they started making calls all over the state and saying, listen, if Canary stays, you know, don't expect anything for us. Billy Canary's been going around recently saying that he's made up with Shelby and team.
Well, I think we know that that's untrue. And you know, we have some pretty good sources there that say that's untrue. And, you know, it just doesn't... It doesn't make any sense from a practical standpoint. At the end of this thing is all money, you know. I mean, it's seriously all the answer to every question here is money. And so if he's no longer making them money, if he's costing them money, if he's costing them on regulations, then that's a problem.
Yep.
That's a huge problem for these people, because otherwise, what are they paying for?
Right. I mean, Charlie, he makes $600,000 a year, and he's being ineffective. I mean, can you imagine what kind of lifestyle you live in Alabama?
I'd do it for half that. Call me.
I definitely agree with Josh on it, though. If he's ineffective, that I certainly think that's a chunk of change we should keep instead of giving it to him.
Yeah, I think BCA would like to keep their money.
But, yeah.
You know, what these guys have said is, look, we may not leave, but we will pull back our money. But the key here is, will these guys stay pat? Will they stay strong and resist Perry Hand and that bunch? I mean, I can't imagine being beat by that bunch of wimps. I mean, really. Charlie, you could take him on in a fair fight.
I could probably take him.
I guarantee you and Susan could wipe the whole bunch out.
Not a problem.
Yeah, we'll take much.
Give us a call.
All right, we're going to have to leave it right there. You're watching The V, the voice of Alabama politics. We'll be right back with more news and analysis.
Energy Institute of Alabama promotes reliable, affordable, and clean energy to help grow our economy, create high-paying jobs, and build public support for Alabama's energy industry. Access to clean, affordable energy continues to be an issue of vital importance in the halls of government and around the kitchen tables across our nation. The Energy Institute of Alabama is the best source of energy industry information and how it affects households across the state, from convenient energy production to alternative fuels to solar power and beyond.
Welcome back to The V, the voice of Alabama politics. lot of fireworks over the last couple of weeks with the campaigns, especially on the Democratic side. Mm-hmm. I think it was last week, the New South Coalition, which is the largest group of African-American mm-hmm. Leaders that has formed. Basically, you've got to have their endorsement to mm-hmm. win a Democratic election. They held their meeting. Walt Maddox was overwhelmingly chosen, endorsed by that team. And Sue Bell Cobb, Chief Justice Sue Bell Cobb, really did not get the kind of warm reception she has in the past, to put it mildly.
Yeah. I was trying to be, that's an understatement.
I was trying to be nice. I mean, Sue Bell's been getting, she's been having a rough time with it.
She has been having a rough time. And, and that little fight there has turned ugly between her and Maddox, and some of it has been deserved from Sue Bell. You know, the letter to about Jeff Sessions, in support of Jeff Sessions, does not sit well with Democrats, and it especially does not sit well with Black Democrats.
Right.
I mean, the views that they have of Jeff Sessions is just not very favorable, and rightfully so in a lot of ways. They were very harsh to her at the News. A couple of folks were very harsh to her at that New South endorsement. And so, I understand where they're coming from. I don't know that it should have been as harsh as it was towards her. I think, that she has done some good things for Democratic folks around and for the more progressive folks in the state. I don't think it should have been necessarily as harsh as it was, but I understand where they're coming from.
And listen, I think Sue Bell Cobb has done a great job as a justice. Mm-hmm. But the thing they brought up, Susan, was that she quit mm-hmm. after they invested
factor.
Millions of dollars in getting her elected Chief Justice. And then she wrote this letter endorsing Jeff Sessions, who most Black folks in Alabama thinks it's stone cold racist. I mean, that's just a fact.
But now they gave it was even weight in between the letter and her quitting, because at that time she was the only statewide Democrat mm-hmm. that they had. And then she turned around and quit as Chief Justice without anything other than, she was just retiring. Now she's coming back, and I like Sue Bell Cobb, but she's coming back and say it was to spend time with her mother, and I understand that. We've all been there, done that. But why didn't she say that at the time? Mm-hmm. Why is this just coming up now? And they took real issue with that. They really took our issue with that.
Well, Charlie, I mean, two of the most outstanding senators on the Democratic side, Senator Hank Sanders, Senator Vivian Figures, mm-hmm. I mean, they were quite blunt.
They were. It was pretty brutal to watch, but they both had outstanding points against her, so I really commend them for everything that they said.
I mean, they were factual. There was
there's no arguing, because most of it is the way that they felt, and I understand the part about them feeling mm-hmm. abandoned, because it was, it kind of led to Roy Moore becoming Chief Justice.
Yeah.
Led to other things, and
good
so
times,
you know,
good
here we
times,
go.
Right?
Yeah,
good times.
Yeah, not exactly. worst times ever, possibly. It's a problem. It's a problem that she's not going to be able to overcome. I think Maddox is pretty clear. I know we're going to talk about who's leading what races here, but it's a problem that she can't overcome, I don't think.
Well, no, I don't think she can either. I mean, and you've got to look at, of that field, they had, six of them in Birmingham at that debate. And then, when you get six people on a stage, I mean, it really is kind of silly. Basically, it was people beating up on Walt Maddox, Walt Maddox taking after Sue Bell, mm-hmm. Sue Bell helping to beat up on Walt Maddox, and other people beating up on Walt Maddox. Yeah. I mean, come on, Josh. That's some of it deserved, some of it not.
It was. And I mean, I think there were some legitimate questions raised about the recovery after the tornadoes in Tuscaloosa. And because Maddox has taken some heavy criticism about how it was more pointed towards the richer folks in Tuscaloosa than it was the minorities and the poor there. But at the same time, at that debate, you're right. When to give an opportunity for everybody on stage to ask a question and all of them ask it of the same person, that person is leading the race.
Right.
And that was Walt Maddox. And listen, I like Maddox. I think that he has, when you ask him questions, he has good answers. Especially for a person like me, a more progressive person who wants to see the place move forward somewhat and to leave a lot of this pandering nonsense behind and implement a lottery and some gambling things here to pay for a few things that we can get done in the future and see our kids go to school for a change.
And you bring up that Walt Maddox is a progressive, but he's a very conservative progressive.
He's got a conservative at home that keeps dragging him back.
We met his wife.
We did,
she is something else. She's a Republican, right, Charlie?
She is a Republican, so I definitely think it's good that he has her in his corner.
Yeah.
Well, I tell you, she told me that how is he going to get people to Republicans vote for him one at a time? And I was like, does he have to ask him to marry him? I mean,
no, but I think that's a good balance.
It is.
Definitely.
It's a really good balance. Susan, the Wetumpka Tea Party, which used to be like this firebrand organization. I mean, you knew if you went to the Wetumpka Tea Party, it was going to be fire and brimstone and politics. At its raw meat level. They had a gathering of Republican candidates. You thought it was, you know, tea and crumpets at the palace.
It basically was tea and crumpets at the palace. There were no speeches.
What's a
there
crumpet?
There were no speeches. There were no questions. They were just basically set up booths so people could go around and meet the candidates.
It's almost like the boogeyman has been removed from their target of hatred over there.
You mean for the black years. Man?
Yes, the black guy that was spending all the money. You remember him?
Yeah.
The reason they kept dressing up like Ben Franklin and going out in public. They've been exposed as phonies. It's phonies. They're phonies. Were there any complaints about Donald Trump and his spending at this place?
Not that I know of, but when you're orange, no one can have anything bad to say about you. Bless the president's heart. Listen. I agree that I'd rather see the firebrand coming down. You know, we got about a minute left, Charlie. I mean, in the governor's race, who's up?
Right now in the governor's race, I think we're looking at Ivy and Maddox. And then in the light gov race, I think we're looking at Twinkle and Ainsworth as being our two leading.
Josh, you know, the big one out there is the attorney general's race. Where do you see it?
I think Troy King is up pretty easily there. And I guess the question now is can Alice Martin or Marshall get into a runoff? And I don't know that they can, the way that the polling looks on that. Especially Marshall's really surprising the way the polls that we've seen. He is way back there.
Yeah, he's sinking like a stone. Yeah. He didn't even show up in Wetumpka.
No, he didn't show up in Wetumpka, of course, based on the last place that he showed up, I wouldn't have shown up either. But anyway, it looks like it may be, if anything, a runoff between Troy King and Alice Martin.
I think it's from what we're hearing, Troy King's getting ready to have a big
infusion
of cash, which will change the dynamic greatly. We're going to leave it right there. You've been watching The V, the voice of Alabama politics. You watch us because we watch them.